I am your host, Mike D. Here at Industry City for a live event tonight. We don't have Tommy with us. Thank God. He's not dead, but he's not with us tonight. But I do have special guests. I have super producer Rob Martin.
Hello.
Hello. I have bkONE specialty guy, Anthony Marino.
I am the specialty guy. Thank
That's
you.
That's it. Yes. He is the bkONE all around point person. I don't know exactly what to call him exactly. I should have got some points probably.
That's all right. Don't
but,
worry.
But we are here doing an amazing live event in Industry City, and I'm just so excited to be able to do this event with you guys.
Well, that's great, Mike. I mean, this is the Jacked Kirby podcast.
That's it.
Thanks for having us.
And we are going to kind of jack this
podcast. I hope so.
Away from you a little bit. But yeah. Like, this is going to be, you know, but a very special episode. We all are also celebrating the beginning of Super Week for mm-hmm. New York Comic Con. And we will have our friends from St. Mark's Comics on in a little bit, just as we have every year for almost the last 10 years.
Yeah, man.
I think so. Anthony, thanks so much for having us here. And if I just, you know, a little bit of the state of the CCD union, just to kind of talk about like what we're doing here and actually where we are. Because this is the first, I think, thing we've really done in here like this, like this. And so where we are is in brooklynONE Productions. Well, actually, we're in the basement studio, aren't
basement,
we?
Yeah, right. So the extension of.
But right. The brooklynONE Productions, Tom Kane Theater here in Industry City in Brooklyn, which is our new home base for all sort of productions. And, you know, I want to talk just quickly about how we kind of ended up here and what we're doing here. But to the point, the basement studio sort of taken after the inspiration from the basement where we sort of started doing these podcasts, you know, about 10 years ago and started working with St. Mark's, you know, almost 10 years ago. And right now we are now sitting in our own private studio.
We got it. Yeah.
And we are live streaming this all to you. Just behind us, there is a kaiju convention that is loading in behind us, our own also private event space and private movie theater and art gallery and basically everything that we've been working for.
theater,
like our, a completely, of course, right? You know, this is a fully functioning studio with all things. And, you know, CCD, which we've been doing, you know, for a number of years, like we've pretty much, you know, Mike, you know, it's how far we've come. Like from you initially starting it as a blog, I think in 2009, was that right? And
yes.
I, you know, myself coming along not too long after that, and then going into multimedia, Anthony coming along as a partner early on there, and us collaborating, and now indeed, CCD sort of pretty much soft merging, you know, with brooklynONE and all of our efforts going through there.
It makes so much sense. I mean, you guys, you know, are always on the bleeding edge of all the pop culture stuff, and you know, you fill that gap so perfectly, and you know, to Tommy's not here.
Tommy's fill the gap.
I let that go.
But you had to. You had to acknowledge it because
I looked at Rob. Yeah, I didn't say anything.
But I said it. Yeah. No. But to have a space, a dedicated space to do all the different projects. You know, to do live theater, to do events, this Kaiju Brooklyn thing that's coming up. We're going to talk about to be able to collaborate with all the amazing vendors and tenants here at Industry City. But you know, to have CCD as a part of it, to stay on top of the pop culture, it's just perfect.
It's really amazing because it's like when the whole thing started and when the whole idea started, it was just a way for us to share stuff with each other. Like it was like a common place where we could post something or put something on that wouldn't be for anybody else. It was just for our friends. It was just for our, you know, counterparts or whatever it was. And then little by little, it started to spread out, and we got to do more opportunities and do great stuff. And this is what I always envisioned it as. And it's because of you guys. I'm so proud of you guys. I say it all the time. I'm so happy for you guys. It sucks because I live in New Jersey now, so I can't get to reap the benefits of it as much. I would like to be around much more. But every time you guys include me and stuff, I'm super happy. And unfortunately, we have to include Tommy from time to time as well. But so it goes. And, you know, we're just so happy to always be involved with Super Week and involved with everything that you guys are doing. So, again, I'm just very proud of you guys. I have to say that from the top because, you know, I never imagined that there would ever be a time when we were doing the things that we talked about doing. And now mm-hmm. we are. Like, we're hosting, you know, events. We're doing film-based projects. We're hosting art shows. We're doing all this stuff. And it's in a space that's ours. So that's pretty awesome.
And in the heart of Brooklyn, you know, and in a really, really cool place. I mean, that's, you know, so when we, you know, started CCD and then, like, I think, you know, like you said, we were making it for our friends and things like that. And then I started doing my podcast for a while. And then we sort of pivoted to the branding of, like, CCD NYC, of really having that New York-ness. Like, that's our pop culture through a New York sort of perspective, even a Brooklyn one. So it's being here is the perfect place for us. And, you know, I thank you, Mike, obviously, for, you know, I guess starting it all those years ago. And then for really you and Tommy keeping the flame burning with Jack Kirby for these number of years. Like, I was doing my podcast and eventually I kind of wanted to focus on it. People have been asking, you know, what I've been doing for these last few years. And I'm like, I've been working on this. This is what we've been trying to get going, you know, something a little bit larger and a little bit,
and it's beautiful
formed. But, you know, you guys, you guys keeping Jacked Kirby going week after week. I mean, I think I did maybe 120 episodes of the CCD podcast, and but you guys have blown past that. I think this is episode 220.5, I think we're calling it.
It is exactly what it is. 220.5.
Nice.
Beautiful. Just a little half episode for you guys.
And a little taste.
The amazing talent that you've spoken to across that, you know, 200 plus episodes, like, it really just runs the gamut of people in the industry, and the way that you've been able to tie it around to have Jack sort of as part of all the conversations, and a very New Yorkness too, right? You guys being very New Yorky, mm-hmm. Jack being a New Yorker, and like expressing that, and a lot of the guests.
Yeah, I think like Tommy gets all the credit in the world because he gets 99.9% of the people to come on the show. The way I feel about things is like I'm friends with most of the people that Tommy is friends with, so I just feel like I bring nothing to the social media aspect of the show. I think, you know, it's important that we're both part of it. And I think that's what makes the show great. But Tommy is great at reaching out to people. Tommy's great at taking shots. And he takes big swings. And when they pay off immense. I mean, Kevin Eastman, that was like huge. Probably, I literally almost died like four times during that interview because it was like, this is the guy who created Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and like I've met him before, it was under a different context, and now I got this guy on a Zoom and I'm like, what's your favorite ice cream? Like, that's I want to ask this guy like all kinds of weird questions, and I know I can't be weird, but I try to like keep it together. And then like Jeff Smith, you know, of Bone fame, like that's Tommy's favorite creator of all time. And he was so excited. And like the whole time that we were leading up to that, I was like, this is going to be kind of nuts because like we're talking to this guy, like this is an untouchable type guy that, and he's giving us an hour. And next thing you know, we're exchanging emails and we're sending Batman covers to each other and talking about things that we talked about on the show. And it's awesome. Like, look, I don't claim to think that this is going to be some long-term, like people are going to remember us or whatever it is. But with that being said, in the short term, we're having the best time ever.
That's so great. I mean, really, yeah, cool. It's great every week, you know, having that to look forward to. And Anthony been with us since the beginning, Athos St. Mark's podcast in the mm-hmm. old location, right, and obviously yeah. in the basement for us, and mm-hmm. part of everything, and you know, us collaborating.
This is the three of us. We did a deep dive on the state of DC movies back.
Yeah,
for sure.
And we were right.
We were right. We nailed it.
It was a shit show. It'll all go to hell. Yeah.
So it's fun to be back with you guys.
But I know, you know, your own journey with Brooklyn One, which we're all, you know, really throwing our weight behind now to really the rising tide and all that. And it's been a long road for you too, bouncing around, you know, doing different, this is why we compliment each other well with our thing, but doing your journey, but like, you getting that hustle to really, you know, for this place. So, I mean,
you know, 17 years, you know, with a...
You only
with,
look 17 years old.
Yeah, yeah. But 17 years with, the, you know, having the company and you know, losing our space in 2014 and then, like, bouncing around, but, like, meeting you guys and, like, you know, again, it was, like, that the creativity of being able to, like, all right, let's, like, go into podcasts. Let's talk about pop culture. Like, let's learn how to produce this stuff. And then, like, you guys would be like, oh, let's help you with, like, one of your shows. Or, like, you're having a 10-year anniversary. Let's come and make content for you. It was, like, it was this perfect merging, you know, back and forth.
Yeah.
And, you know, again, like, we ended up here at Industry City, and it was just like, well, I want to do this with the people that that I love and I trust, my creative partners and stuff, and it's just a natural fit. It goes right back to that.
Cool. So I just want to plug the event tomorrow just a little right now, but yep. I want to get into that a little deeper when we have John and yeah, other John folks on.
Yep.
But tomorrow is Kaiju Brooklyn, yeah, which is here at Industry City, which will we have 20 vendors in the in our space who will be selling all sorts of kaiju wares, and we're going to be all day, and we'll also be live streaming the event all day. It'll be on the same channel.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be talking to a number of the different creators,
yeah,
and we're also there'll be a screening of Shin Ultraman. And we are partnered with, it's an official thing. We're not, you know, we're not even worried about getting sued,
yeah,
or anything.
Yeah, it's actually,
like, it's legit.
Yeah. Oh, first time for everything, right?
Like,
right.
I'm always like, what
can we... We're all about leveling up now, right?
What music can we use? What movie can we use? And are we going to get in trouble,
it's
you
legit.
Know?
Shin Ultraman, legit.
But that is going to be huge. But what else is coming up for the Tom Kane Theater?
Sure, yeah. So here at Brooklyn One, you know, we obviously, you know, we got the Kaiju Brooklyn, which, by the way, Kaiju Brooklyn, that event, and I know John will talk about it later, but talk about the perfect merging of
exactly.
bkONE and CCD. Like, it's a, I never would have jumped into something like that without knowing I had you guys to back it up. But later this month, you know, next week we've got the return of our one act festival, which is like our signature event. That's how we started back in the day, and we haven't had a one act festival in almost 10 years, so it's a huge thing to have that back. Later in the month, we've got Midsummer Remixed. We're taking our Midsummer Night's Dream adaptation and we're turning it into a club experience here in the theater for one night. On the 21st of October, we've got the Nightmare Group Art Show, which again,
the leveling perfect, up from our, yep. yeah, our, you know, not that there was anything wrong with being in the back of a bar.
It's about having
like,
a more of a curated space, right?
Yeah.
To have, and more artists, because we have more wall space now. And Tommy is helping to lead that and to curate that. And then to finish off the month, you know, we've got a huge event. We've got Rocky Horror coming back on the 28th. And, that is just...
That's going to be massive.
That's massive.
So massive. That'll be a live screening and, you know, interactive classic Rocky screening with... We did a couple hundred people last year that came, and we'll also be having a private VIP party beforehand,
yep.
Halloween party. So if you want to get in on that, check it out.
It just absolutely kills me that I can't be a part of this on a Saturday. I wish you guys would.
What are you doing that night?
Multiple. You got to do multiple nights. We got to get this going.
Take off that night. What do you
just
got?
Take off?
I can't. It's tough. But
he doesn't want to drive.
What I think is at this point, we're ready for a two nights event. Well, I'm ready for a two night event.
Oh, okay.
So next year we have to do.
He's right. He's ready.
I think everybody's ready. I think you guys would definitely command the audience. I know everybody who came. Literally everybody, even people who don't like us,
yeah.
came and said they had a great time.
That's true.
So,
that's true.
I mean, I think ultimately at the end of the day, it'll be a good time. And I think you guys are going to kill it as usual. I'm a huge Rocky Horror fan. And so I'm disappointed that I won't be here, but I'll be with you guys in spirit.
Well, we'll do a time warp for you.
Nice.
Yeah. No problem.
Well, thanks, Anthony.
Yeah.
I know you're
really
busy loading in over
here,
and I know we have some other guests, and we don't have any interns. So if you can go get,
I'll go get our next special guest.
We still need crew.
Yeah. Thank you, gents. I love you both.
But thank you,
absolutely,
so much,
more,
Anthony.
Brother.
So, tell us the last couple episodes of Jacked. Like, what's been going on?
So,
and
it's been fun. We're in the middle of Jacktober,
right?
So we always kind of launch Jacktober for October. There's a couple of different meanings to Jacktober. Jacktober is a sketch activity that happens on Instagram and Facebook, where people will draw one image of Jack Kirby every day. So they'll take a character, or they'll take a scene, or they'll take something. Tommy is participating in this. It's an ink drawing, and they have to, you know, just do a simplistic drawing of a character or whatever. And there's different prompts for every day. That's the traditional comic Jacktober. Us, we like to focus more on the spooky stuff and the stuff that Jack and Joe Simon and all his collaborators throughout the years worked on. It's the one genre that Jack Kirby kind of came back to many, many times.
Monsters are part of everything he's ever did, pretty much.
All our friends are monsters, right? Yeah, like, yeah. That's literally something that I've been working on in my head, and it's a truth, right? Like, horror has transcended the last 150 years, let's say. And it's a group activity. It's something that makes people excited to do it together. And you can't really think of another genre that really fits that same format. And Jack, you know, he was always doing whatever needed to be done for the industry. It just so happens that just like film, just like TV, it always reverts back to the mean. And horror is always going to be the most profitable and easiest win. You might end up with a victory in another genre, but you could take 7-8 swings before you actually connect. Horror, all you got to do is put some out, and people will usually, if it's halfway good, people will like it. If it's great, forget about it. Like, you're gonna get such a reaction.
I think you forgot to do like a crazy spooky, like Tommy did that spooky voice in the last one.
It was good.
You should have done
it.
It was really good. He did do it. I can't top that.
I won't even try, because he got me by surprise and I almost fucking pissed myself on camera when he did it. But you know, it's really important part of their body of work. It's something that gets overlooked. I mean, you say Jack Kirby is like, this guy created Captain America, this guy created the Fantastic Four, but he's produced probably as many horror comics as many, you know, like such a crazy amount of horror comics. And it's like, oh yeah, he also did that. And so for October, we try to focus on that a little bit. Plus all the Marvel monsters, which everybody loves so much.
Right.
I mean, everybody knows Groot, and they know this one, and they know that one, but we try to, like, maybe highlight some of the ones that they might not. We've been doing this for a couple of years now, so it's getting harder and harder, because we've already run through so much stuff, but yet here we are. We try to make it a little bit unique.
That's great.
Every October.
So I got our next guest. Come on in. We need an applause. Sign. Go ahead. You use your... and stay pretty close to the, you know, we're freaking ourselves. We have Mitch Cutler, owner, co-owner, proprietor of St. Mark's Comics, legendary St. Mark's Comics, which is here now in Industry City, which we've been doing, collaborating with you for a number of years. How's it going, Mitch?
It's going all right. It's a frightening number of years. I don't want to really think about
it. We don't really count.
I did want to jump in. I was listening to all that Jack Kirby stuff, and I was reading some post somewhere, and it talked about the Big Jim ads, and a light bulb went on in my head, and I had to go find an old comic, and I hadn't realized. I suppose in the back of my lizard brain, I knew that it was Jack Kirby.
Yeah,
but actually, you look at an ad and it's just unbelievably obvious.
Yeah, he did all the art for that. It was like a kind of A-Team style-esque, probably predated the A-Team.
Oh, I'm sure it
did. But I mean, you know, very, very contemporary look at a team, so to speak. And my local mom and pop shop now is Kevin Smith's Jay and Silent Bob. And I went there, and one day he was like, I got something to show you. And he had like an original Big Jim in the box and everything. He had it in the basement, and he went and he got it, and he was like, look at this. Like, and we got to take pictures for it and put it on the site. And it was cool, because that's one of his like hidden gems.
It just made me think of you.
Yeah, thank you.
That's cool. Can you hear us okay, Mitch?
I can hear you.
Great. Thanks for having us here. We're kicking off.
Thanks for coming.
Super Week, right? The artist formerly known as Super Week, at New York Comic Con, which is a week from today, right? Or yesterday, Thursday.
Yeah, starts
kicks off
on Thursday.
And you guys have got your space on the floor.
We do.
The classic space.
No,
they've kind of screwed everybody, I think, a little bit.
they've reconfigured.
Yeah, reconfigured.
Here I was trying to be.
Yeah, sorry. We don't have a booth, so we can talk shit. But yeah,
I'll be there Thursday. So.
Yeah, but yes, I've heard they've moved some things around.
They've moved everything around. We're in 35, 39, and they have reconfigured the floor.
Sure.
And
the prices.
No, the prices haven't reconfigured. They have steadily crept up, as they always do.
It's not a reconfiguration at all.
But, you know, it's New York Comic Con. You got to be there. Yeah. I can't imagine the universe in which you don't go to New York.
I mean, it's going
to
be huge. I mean, last year was still a bit, but we were still sort of trickling out of COVID for the last couple of years. And this year, it's going to be, I'm sure, massive all over that space.
I think so, too. Yeah. And another... if this holds true to what reports I have gotten from San Diego, because of the actor strike and the lack of particularly sexy panels, I mean, they're so desperate for panels, I might be on one. That's
why we have you here.
Really.
So I'm trying to jump the gun.
Sorry, I couldn't help it. I couldn't.
That's all right. Totally deserved it. So the sales floor is likely to be extra crazy.
Right. Well, that was, I think,
full Sunday mode, right? Like anybody who goes to the con and is a comic fan knows that Sunday's the day to like really push for shopping, because everybody's like, I don't want to take the shit home with me. I want to get rid of it on Sunday, right? And as a customer, I know it's probably not the same for a retailer, but as a customer, we're always like, okay, well, if I'm coming all 4 days, I'm going to kind of pace out how I'm going to do this. Maybe I could save a little bit if I offer him this on Sunday.
That is not our experience.
I think it's going to be like that across the board. I think Thursday is going to be pretty much everybody's going to be there to shop from the day.
Our experience, which you never know, could change from year to year, but our experience is that Thursday is serious.
Yeah.
People who come on Thursday are people who are able to take the day off in the middle of the week.
I used to like to do it. Well, it used to be the bonus day. That was the real day to go,
Yeah, that's my favorite.
And you're
thing.
Getting a first shot at everything. Right. And people are there to do serious business.
Yeah, I agree.
But I mean, so San Diego, it's interesting, we're seeing the industry change again over these 10 years, where it started becoming like MovieCon, right? And like that sort of, Twilight took over
TV
at one of the things. But so this past year with, strikes, but also like a lot of the studios have their own sort of thing now. Disney has like D23, DC does its like own like little thing. So they've sort of fragmented themselves to the point where they were like, oh great, people were like, Comic-Con's not gonna have all this shit. I'm like, they're gonna have comics. Like, it's a little bit of a return to form in that way, of it really focusing on the thing. I think that's awesome, we'll see if that's holding true too at New York. But I get everybody, which makes sense, they all want to have their own moment, right? Comics, we can have our comic moment. That's what it used to be. So I hope that works out great. I hope that holds true at New York. Like you said, it strikes and everything. And
it should be pretty interesting.
Also, that's like kind of coming to an end. So we don't know
Well, the writer's strike is settled, but the actor's strike is not.
Yeah. So you don't know who's going to be around, who's not going to be around.
But it was always like, I like movies and pop culture and all everything, obviously. But, it was overwhelming at those. And you would have buried in the back were just like the classic sort of, Comic-Con style booths and things. So I think it's cool to see. It's interesting. Things come and go, right? I mean, you've been around a long time, Mitch. You've seen pop culture evolve.
Oh, is that a shot?
A little bit.
As a professional, and I'm sure as a fan, even before then, you've seen trends come and go. We've talked about that usually every year when we kind of talk to you. We talk about kind of like what's hot and like how things have changed. I mean, this is a good segue. how have things been going at the shop here in Industry City, and what are people into?
It's going well. Yeah. This summer was a surprising. It wasn't the normal gangbuster summer, but it was still strong. We have seen since over the last 2 weeks, it's been crazy. I mean, here we are. This is our kickoff event for Comic-Con, and today was nothing but tourists in town for Comic-Con.
Wow.
We were nuts all day with just that.
That's and we're great. A week out. Yeah, even. Yeah. 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 That's great. And so just in general, like what kind of books have been moving lately? Like what have you seen anything being really popular lately? I know a lot of the kids stuff in the past has been really popular for you guys. And
yeah, we continue to be surprised by the astonishing number of kids at this location. And in fact,
they're out right now. It's 10 o'clock at night. And they're like,
it really is. They're right out in the courtyard.
Yeah. Crazy maniacs.
It is
on a Saturday afternoon. I'm terrified walking around. Well,
as you should be,
but
it's like hostile.
Yeah. It's such a draw that we were so excited that I'll run through all our events, but next Friday is Faith Erin Hicks will be signing her new book.
Wow.
And that's we're great. Super excited to bring that here for just that reason.
So cool.
Tons of kids. As always, quality will out. There's a new Dan Klaus book this week and we've gone through half our stock already. It's been out for 3 days.
So Monica?
Yeah, Monica. Yeah.
Oh,
that's right.
Man. So good.
So
cool.
Great. The more things change, the more things
stay
the same.
So what do you have coming up for Super Week the con?
Of course, we're here this evening and we're happy to renew the partnership.
We're here. We were talking a little bit, we were talking about the space that we're in. This is and everything. We are directly behind you. St. Mark's Comics is right on the other side of this wall. So it's cool to be continuing this relationship and being so close with you, which is awesome. And they're happy to of course we're here. Go ahead. Sorry.
No worries. And tomorrow we're partnering with bkONE to be part of the Kaiju Fest.
Kaiju Brooklyn.
Yes. And we're excited to be doing that. We couldn't fit any giant monsters in the courtyard. It's big, but not that big. But we'll be having stuff, and we'll be having a table here and our usual things. We start again on Tuesday night. One of our alumni is Chris Nissen, who is NYC Toy Life. So he's a pretty famous toy photographer, and he's got a lot of reviews, and everybody said a bunch of great stuff. And he'll be here. He's going to do a little mini exhibition. He's going to have his prints for sale, and he's going to do a raffle if you buy a print.
I think I spoke to him at the Brooklyn Independent Comics Showcase. Was he one of the guys in that? I spoke with him. He's a great photographer. Yeah,
he's a great photographer. He's super talented, and he's doing the top prize of the raffle is a $100 gift certificate to St. Mark's Comics. So
cool,
like that. So he'll be here on Tuesday, and then we're going to go back to the Godzilla well. On Wednesday night, Dean Haspiel is going to be here.
Friend.
He'll be signing Godzilla Library Volume 1 is coming out this week. And so he's got work in it. He'll be signing that.
Cool.
And he's going to bring Peter Rostovsky with him, who has his own book. And Dean will have a selection of his earlier stuff. But, we're going to stick with the giant lizard stuff.
Cool.
Dean is an old friend of the show. And we're very happy. Cool. Anytime that we hear that he's doing something, we try to share it out. So we'll make sure we put that out there.
Absolutely. Thursday night is kind of a different thing. We're also partnering with bkONE on this one. So we've all seen bad Christmas movies, and they all have certain things in common. And they've made a terrific game called Bad Christmas Movie Bingo. So we'll be showing a movie here, and everyone will get to play. And the games will be for sale after you realize how much fun it is to play Bad Christmas Movie Bingo. So
that's Comic-Con.
It's all free.
Right.
It's all free, and that's the Thursday night is. And all of these events are 8 to 10, so you can go to the show. After the show is over, you got time to get here. And we'll also be running a promotion. If you come with your flyer and your New York Comic-Con badge, you'll get 20% off anything you buy.
Oh my.
So it's a little incentive to get folks to make that trip across the water, which is really only like 25 minutes. So it's not that bad. Friday night, as I mentioned, is the big signing. It's Faith Erin Hicks has a new book out, Hockey Girl Loves Drama Boy. And we're super excited. We'll have that book. We'll have a bunch of her other books. She'll be doing a Q&A with another one of our alumni. And then taking some questions and doing some interviews. And then after that, she'll be signing books. And then we'll wrap it up on Saturday with Nicholas Tanna. He's got a new book out called E-Junkie.
Oh, cool.
And he will be signing that.
That's stacked, stacked week, Mike.
As always. I mean, they don't disappoint. Just because they moved to Brooklyn doesn't mean that things are going to change.
No.
This is the way it's always
been. They're ratcheting it up.
Yeah.
They got more space.
We got more space to play. That's the secret. We got more space to play with so we can do bigger events. And we love that.
Yeah, for sure.
That's fantastic.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, everyone, go to St. Mark's Comics every single day down here at Industry City. And, of course, go visit you guys at New York Comic Con and check out all these events.
I will be there Thursday.
All right.
I'm going to be at your booth terrorizing you.
That's terrific. We look forward to it. We can't wait to be
Mike does come in.
Stuff
he's like a giant kaiju.
Yeah, push stuff over. I'm going to say I'm acting out this weekend's events.
Excellent. No, excellent.
Just kidding.
That's great, and we look forward to hanging out with you all day tomorrow. And yeah, it's going to be insane, I think, tomorrow for the Kaiju Brooklyn.
I think it will be pretty wild.
We're going to get quite a crowd, I think.
I am expecting such.
Good.
Who doesn't love big monsters?
That's right, man.
Fantastic.
That's
right. All right. So, are you done with me?
Yeah, I think so. Unless you have anything else you'd like
to. All right. Now, here's the only other thing I'd like to say. I'll shake your hand. I'll leave you hanging. All right.
We're on a live stream. Whatever.
So, I'm going to make my escape, and I will send over my partner, Nick.
Absolutely. That'd be great.
With a bunch of cool toys.
I can't wait.
So he could talk about cool toys, because I know that you want to talk about cool toys.
We love cool toys.
Right? You tolerate me so you can get to the cool toys. That's it. I get it.
We love cool toys.
All right. Thank you so much,
Thank
guys.
You very much, man.
Now I'm going to shake your hand.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Cool. Good luck with Comic-Con.
As always. Mitch is just a very grateful guy and a very helpful guy to have in your corner. He's been allowing us to participate in this for so long, so it's been great and a great partnership. So I remember the first time we went down there. It was kind of intimidating.
Oh, for sure.
For us, like, right?
Well, I've been going there for like 30 years.
That's what I'm saying.
Like,
yeah,
you know, it was like I didn't think it could get any better. Like, I felt like we made it.
Yeah, and I also thought, like, one of the coolest parts was, like, he was like, so you guys want anything? Like, I'll send somebody to get coffee.
And we're like, oh.
We were like, well, I'll take coffee. You know, like, I'll take coffee. And then they put the table out for us, right. And they, like, over the comics.
It was
that
cool.
That was existing. And I was like, this is exactly where the fuck I thought they'd put it.
It's so funny. Crazy. Like, yeah. We have a giant space. We have no audience. We used to invite people to there, and there's like no room, you know, like 6 inches.
Yeah. We'd be like, come, just stand outside and just cheer us on. And we're not live streaming.
So it's funny, you know, Mitch saying, like, I mean, I do like comics, but I am as I gotten older, a little more toy centric and having, but the one book that I am interested in, I meant to ask him about, and I'm probably good, is they finally did Wolverine versus Predator. Which is just the dream, like my 11-year-old dream, just come through, like claw versus claw, you
this
know, like
is
what it's about.
A little bit of the.
Have you been reading it?
I have been. I've been reading the Alien stuff that has been also produced.
Right.
As a current Marvel app purchaser and purveyor of digital comics. I think what digital comics does is the same things that like Napster did for music. Everybody was like, oh, this is going to be the end of the music industry. It's like, no, this is going to allow people to spend their money better because the things they like and the things that they try are going to be the things that if they're collectors, they're going to collect. And, you know, I think same thing happened to us with music when we thought that it was going to be, oh my God, like everybody's gonna just download everything and we're never gonna have to deal with it. But it was like, no, I download it. I didn't have to pay for it. It's good. Now I wanna buy it. Now I wanna buy more and more of it. So the Fox Marvel merger has been pretty good.
Yeah.
And we've gotten some great comics. The Aliens book is great. The Wolverine.
Maybe we get Aliens versus the Brood. You know, maybe that.
We're getting it. We'll get there maybe eventually.
All right, let's bring on our next guest here. Come on in, Nick. This is you're wearing a really cool shirt. Come on in here. Nick is the co-owner of St. Mark's Comics and sort of generally known as the toy guy. How you doing, Nick?
I'm all right. How are you guys doing?
I'm great.
Put that right up there, if that's helpful.
Okay, yeah, that's good right there. And we can showcase here. Caitlin, let us know if anything angle-wise is necessary. Thanks so much for being here, Nick. How's it going?
All right. Yeah,
put it right there. Put it on the side right there. If that's it. Great.
All right. There we go. How's that?
Good. All right, thanks for being here again. We've had you on before. How's it going?
Going well. Going well.
Good. Mitch just gave us a great rundown of what's going on with Super Week. Cool. And but how's the toy angle been in St. Mark's for the last year or so?
Well, we can't keep them in stock.
All right.
So, it's a good problem to have.
Yeah.
That's good. And so we've got the big... Kaiju Brooklyn mm-hmm. Fest happening tomorrow. I think maybe you brought us some toys to look at.
I brought some toys of what's going on right now in the shop.
Great.
Not a lot of kaiju stuff.
Okay, not specifically kaiju, but what's been going on. Gotcha. Let's see what we got here.
So I brought a few different things here. We got new stuff. We got old stuff. What do you want to start with?
Let's go with this guy right here.
All right. So we bought a very large collection of DC Direct figures. We're in the process of getting it all priced and put out. This was, I want to say, two full van loads of stuff, 70 boxes of comics, and then a bunch of like toys like this. So it's a lot of the DC product that's been out of production for, you know, 10, 15 years now. Cool to get it all back at once. A lot of Batman, a lot of Superman. That one in particular is a Harley Quinn, always popular.
Yeah,
That was one of the better Harley figures they ever did. It's based on the Jim Lee artwork from Hush.
From the Hush mm-hmm. line. Yeah, very cool. These are popular. This batch that you got. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great. I love that Hush comic. That's
yeah, and that was definitely like a moment where I think a lot of people, like myself, had kind of stepped away from comics.
Exactly.
And then we kind of worked our way back, and then this was like one of the storylines that kept us hooked back in. So luckily here we are.
There was a cool story
later, right?
Okay. Caitlin's all right. Good enough. Great. Yeah, okay. I'm going to move this.
Take that one off. I'll take that one.
I'm keeping all. Oh, we got to careful here. Ooh, we got to be careful with this guy. Yeah.
Monkey Man.
This is for our ape friends.
Yeah. We bought a vintage Mego collection a couple weeks ago. A bunch of Planet of the Apes, most of which are gone now. I've still got this guy left. And also some Our Gang, Little Rascals figures.
Migos too?
Yeah, Migos.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. And Migo was, you know, popular figure line.
This line is great. The I can see it right here on the back. The Village. Did you get one? Did you get the playset? Village?
No, just,
to come
just
in?
Just a few of the figures.
Did we get the Action Stallion?
No, I wish.
Jesus.
This isn't bad. I mean, obviously a little damage to the bubble, mm-hmm. and the card back got a little bit of wear and tear, but not
warping,
bad at all.
But that's, I mean, come on. That's crazy.
Considering the age, it just gives it a lot of character.
That's this
great.
Is, you know, Dr. Zay. This is a great line. I mean, we have a few friends who are huge ape fans. Remember, we did a whole, at one point back on the CCD podcast, we did a whole retrospective of all Planet of the Apes movies. I'm really curious to see what the new one they're going to put together.
Yeah.
But this is a great line. I mean, Mego, I mean, that was it. Oof. It was what it was all about for a while. Love it. Love it.
Good stuff. What do we got?
We also bought a very large collection of Funko Pops yesterday, all Spider-Man
I've
related.
Never heard of these. Do people like these?
What is a
you know,
fun
just a little
pop.
Bit. So I try not to to push these too much because they are everywhere, but it was a unique Spider-Man collection. It was all Spidey.
I mean, they're cool to see this. Some of them, I think everybody has at least one Funko Pop because there's always like, because they make everything. It's a really crazy deep cut. But there are some comic book stores I walk into and it's like, oh, you guys just sell Funko Pops? It seems like it's the entire place.
I will say that I do love the Spider-Ham.
Amazing.
I can't believe
it exists.
So not only that, but I can't believe since the Spider-Verse, there's been multiple toys of it, and that my seven-year-old son, that's his favorite like, Spider-Man.
Knows who Spider-Ham is.
That's his favorite Spider-Man.
Oh, my God.
And
of course.
Like, do you want it? Okay, I get it. A little bit, I do get it. It's pretty great. And when I saw that, when you pulled it out, I was like, yes, that's great. That's what I was hoping for.
These are cool. I mean, the real deep cut horror movie ones. I mean, it's never ending, right?
Yeah, they don't stop. They don't stop playing.
All right. Got a little bit more. Let's go.
Of course.
Oh.
We got Transformers. We bought a big collection of Transformers today. And another collection last week. So there's always, always more Transformers.
Who is this?
This is Shattered Glass Jetfire. Shattered Glass is basically the mirror universe for Transformers, where the good guys are the bad guys and the bad guys are the good guys. So if you know Jetfire, normally he's red and white, and he's, you know, he was the Macross Jet.
Yeah, yeah.
And here he is in his evil deco from that that evil mirror universe.
Black and purple. Makes perfect sense, yeah.
What era toy is this?
This is a fairly recent release. It was a Hasbro Pulse exclusive.
Okay.
2-3 years ago. And so it's out of production now. But the Commander class stuff, once it sells out, they tend to shoot up a little bit.
Is this multiple robots that come together?
Nope,
he's just Jetfire, right? Yeah, I thought Jetfire. So. I mean, yeah. I can see the on the back here too. This is a good looking figure.
Yeah, it's pretty.
I think I had the old Jetfire. Yeah, as a kid, I was a big fan. Yeah, the red and. This is great. Transformers move really well.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, very, very popular now, right?
I fill that case with new stuff every week or two, and it's always, always, always empty again.
Yeah, yeah.
So there's always new stuff there.
It's amazing.
It's more than meets the eye.
yuck. That's cool. Yeah, I got something else there.
In terms of big. New product, it was hard to find new product that, you know, isn't already sold out. But we do the NECA figures, they continue to be popular. This is the latest Gargoyles figure, and that line has just been killer. It's all we can do to keep them in stock. We reorder them as often as we can, whenever they have them. We got another big shipment coming, I want to say late December, early January, of all the guys we're currently sold out of.
This show is just 30 years old. I think it might have been 93 when it premiered. And like the timing has been so perfect for this line, the millennial nostalgia for like everybody got old and they were all like, oh my God, Gargoyles. Like really for such a popular brand, it's kind of really underrepresented in pop culture. Yeah. I think pretty soon that's going to change. I think they're going to make a movie or a reboot or something. It's going to be huge.
This was also one of the signature launching titles of Disney Plus. So during COVID, when they were like, hey, Disney Plus, you get The Mandalorian, and you get this Jeff Goldblum show, and then you were like, I watched those fucking 12 episodes. What do I do now? And they're like, and there's Gargoyles, and everybody was like, oh wow, I haven't seen that.
Yeah, seen 30, that forever.
25,
oh my God,
28,
Gargoyles.
20 years. And I think a lot of people realize the value of it. It's one of the most intelligent cartoons that's ever been.
It's
written.
Great.
Yeah.
It was one of the first things I watched on Disney Plus. I rewatched the whole thing and I was like, great. And then the toys started coming out like very, very shortly after that. Yeah. I'm sure it was kind of timed to hit. But with COVID being so interesting, where we were all home and just when you have 24 hours to consume stuff, it turns into like, hey, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. I guess I'll start Gargoyles. That'll be great. It's like, no problem. And it was a perfect time for people like us. People always say, like, our generation was built for the pandemic. Because we're like, oh, we get to stay home.
It's the greatest time
movies.
Of my life. Yeah, I've been training for this my whole life.
I was like, let's go. Let's get back to this kid. Like, hopefully. No, God forbid.
I haven't come out of my house yet. This is the first
exactly.
time.
Exactly.
This is a great line, though. I bought Goliath as a pre-order, and I got Brooklyn. Those of course. I noticed this guy's got, includes Brooklyn's closed wings. So this is how to get you.
That's how they get you.
If I want to get the other
They've
one.
They followed the toy line mystique. They know what they're doing.
I mean, NECA is a beast, you know, of its own.
They got they got a lot of stuff going on for the Halloween season as well.
Yeah, so. Great. Was that it, Nick? Was that the last one? Was that the last
all my
item?
Props I brought with
so I mean, there is a really impressive toy selection inside of St. Mark's Comics, I've told you this before. That was even in the classic store. That was always my favorite spot to go, all the way in the back, and I head right to the back usually when I come in there. And it's a really great display and really runs the gamut. I think I've told you before. The great thing about St. Mark's is it carries some of the legacy content, older content on the racks, like in the store, and like it's not always all protected behind glass and stuff. And it really feels like a cool vintage experience.
I always feel like they invited us there because they knew you were a mark and you were going to spend way more money than it cost to have
yeah,
us.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's why Mitch is annoyed that, like, yeah. we're in the studio. No, yeah. He's like, because, oh, I want them to come in and buy Batman
did
shit.
Did you not want that Hercules, the animated series, you know?
That's why I didn't mention Predator and Wolverine while Mitch was here, because I'm like, he'd show up with, like, six trade paperbacks. I'm like, oh, you want these?
I used to, it was like, okay, this is what we're doing. We're taking home a whole playset. Okay, great.
I think what I'm going to do now that we have this basement studio here is we're going to start decorating that, and I'm just going to bring all that shit here. We're just going to display all the stuff I bought at St. Mark's just directly behind St. Mark's, you know?
You guys are going to need a bigger space.
Well, thanks so much, Nick. You'll be at
Comic-Con for the week. I'll be doing all the setup and the booth building and all of that this week. So.
And for the events here and stuff. And yeah, we'll be around tomorrow for Brooklyn Kaiju or Kaiju Brooklyn and there's all kinds of cool toys and stuff. I'm sure you're excited as a fan and in general just to see all the kinds of cool stuff. Yeah. But thanks again.
Thanks for having me.
Always,
good
to be here, Nick.
Guys.
I'll see you Thursday.
Yeah, we'll see you then. You
come knock.
Yeah, let's
shit
give him his stuff back.
All right, I guess. Hold on, this one's coming.
That one's coming with you.
I don't have Brooklyn's wings. No.
You need Brooklyn's closed wings. It's very specific because if you want to create a diorama, where they're.
Fucking nerd. Anyway, I'm very excited.
Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Yeah. I can't wait to go by. I always go by St. Mark's booth, and I'm always sucked right in. They have a great selection of stuff. They bring old and the new. It's very similar to the shop. So, like, if you think, like, okay, I have very limited space on the Comic-Con floor, I'm going to only bring what I know is definitely gonna be like the thing. And it's like, nah, they kind of mix it up. There's something for everybody. So when people see their sign, they know that's a place, like it's like a safe haven, you know?
I mean, it does have a brand and people do recognize it. And we've always thought it was really cool and happy associating with them.
Always good to see those guys over there.
Cool, so I think we've got one final guest we're gonna bring on.
Nice.
To really segue into our big event tomorrow at Kaiju Brooklyn. Come on in. Come on in, John.
Hell of a
shirt. Yeah. We'll see if he stays conscious while we're speaking, because John from Robo7, right?
That's me.
And who really is sort of the whole reason we're doing the Kaiju Brooklyn Festival and our con, and has brought this to us. And, you know, we're big pop culture fans, but you are like Mr. Kaiju and Mr. Ultraman, really. We have some of your wares behind us. But thanks so much for, you know, being here and obviously partnering with us on the event and everything. But why don't you tell us a little bit about, I mean, you can talk about Kaiju Brooklyn and then tell us a little bit about, you know, your journey that got you here to doing this.
It's been a strange journey for sure. And again, thank you guys in the bottom of my heart for taking this very strange journey with me, because it went from a pipe dream to a reality. And here we are on the eve of something that, you know, started as like a tiny little, you know, spark in my brain last year. But basically, I was doing a big Kaiju show out in Chicago every year, and recently there's been some rule changes to the artist alley aspect to it, where artists are not allowed to sell their artwork anymore. And it's just kind of a strange situation. I won't go into details.
Is that true?
Yeah, there's
Okay, off the air. We don't want to talk too much trash.
Yeah, because there's a lot of good people that are involved in the show. So that was frustrating, but again, I do a lot of shows here in New York. New York Comic Con, Anime NYC, Five Points, and what I noticed is that every time I do shows, I make a crap load of money. And I don't mean to say that to boast, but it's very noticeable when I was outselling artists. I don't want to name artists either, but I was sitting next to a very talented pro DC and Marvel artist at New York Comic Con in 2019, and he pointed to me on the last thing and said, yo man, you probably made like X amount of thousands, and he wasn't far off. And he's like, I probably made $300. And I noticed I was like outselling other comic artists around me. So it's like, okay, so there's something to this. I do a lot of Kaiju fan art, obviously. And I started noticing every show I did, I would make more money, I'd get more recognition. And I said, obviously the fan base is here in New York. Now, what people don't know is that there was a Godzilla convention here in the 90s called G-Con, which I went to. And the owners of that show had a rift, and one of them went to Chicago to start G-Fest. And the other one stayed behind, and it just sort of fell to the wayside. But that show basically started here. So we know the market's here. It's also the biggest media market in the world, the highest population density on the East Coast. So it's obvious, like it's all here. The only problem with New York is logistics and where to hold shows, the exorbitant price of venues and such. So last year I was approaching Tsuburaya, who owns Ultraman, about getting the license to make officially licensed t-shirts. Got that, and I don't know how I got the idea of doing a show, but I started, I know what it was. I did an event at Japan Society, and they do these kaiju screenings, and we would set up a few booths outside, and it was like, you ever go to like a Disney ride, and you get out into the gift shop, and people just buying like, you know, I got to get a Small World t-shirt, right?
Small World bottle opener.
Yeah, like, it's ridiculous.
I didn't even know they had
right,
that.
Right.
Yeah. So we would do these screenings, and then people would come out, and I made more money in 45 minutes than I did like all day at like some other shows. So I said, okay, maybe we could do an event in New York. Maybe we could set up in a theater. Maybe we could try Japan Village. So I kept trying Japan Village over and over and over again. Never got back to me. A good friend of mine named Rob Trauma, who works in Industry City up at Federa Guitars, he gave me the contact for Japan Village. Nothing ever happened. I said, look, I just want to set up a table. I got to sell these licensed shirts I just made. I want to see what happens. They never got back to me. Rob said, hey, my friend Anthony opened up a venue called bkONEproductions inside Industry City. And he said he's looking to maybe do some events. Maybe you could pitch him your Godzilla show. I said, all right, cool. So I came here around, was like July I came and met you guys?
Yeah, something like that.
Like mid-July, I said, hey, let's meet up. And there was a lot of back and forth because we were all taking vacations and whatever. So what happened was, I work in Hollywood, I paint sets for movies and TV shows, like movies like Men in Black 3, Amazing Spider-Man 2, blah, blah, blah. I was on a show called The Blacklist that just finished this year, so I was on there for 10 years. And it was tough because it was 9 months of my life that was sort of hijacked. Making great money, but it's like I want to do other things. And just so happens, the literal week that we wrap, the writers go on strike. So I'm like, Summer of John Belotti, here we go. Like Robo 7 taking over New York. And then a month later, the actors went on strike. When that's pretty much when I met Anthony. I said, look, man, I'm going to be out of work for a while. So I have
Robo
time.
Robo 7 needs you.
Yeah, we need each other, man. So the other thing is that on top of all this, I've been doing events for so long around the country and in New York. I had so many connections, like the good people at Anime NYC, Tribeca Film Festival, Japan Society, now Ultraman Connection, that's the official English language website for Ultraman here in the United States. I had all these people, plus these legit toy vendors and artists like Dope Pope, who worked on the Legendary films. And I said, I want to put all these people in a room together and see what happens. And I started pitching them this idea, like early in the spring and summer, like, I'm thinking about doing like a kaiju show, are you in? And they were like, let's do it. It's low cost. It's local. What do we have to lose? On top of that, again, all this sort of stuff sort of like coalesced. It's not like just one thing. It's just a combination of things of like the right time, the right moment. Me being unemployed for 5 months, I was like, let me make use of my time. I got all these connections, met up with you and Anthony. You guys were, you know, from the start, we were like, let's do this. Let's work together. Because I said, I have the resources, you guys have the venue and the logistics, let's see if we can do something. So we did, and I said, maybe we could do something in the spring, like 2 or 3 days, and Anthony said, how about we do it in early October? And I went, oh, fuck, like, oh, okay. okay. And originally it went from 3 days to 2 days, and then with time of the essence, putting on a show, it turned into 1 day. Now, I got married, right, years ago, and it took a year to prep, like, a one-day event. Definitely not enough time, but I had nothing but time, and I was slowly prepping this show with friends and stuff for months. So I sold out of vendor tables in 24 hours when we announced the show. So literally the entire month of August, when we announced the show on August 5th, hit the ground running, and the ticket sales started off good, then they slowed, then it got better when we announced the movie, and then it got to the point where, as you know, we had to close pre-sale because
we didn't want to risk it.
We didn't want to risk it, and now people are saying, I missed out. Can I get tickets? You can get tickets at the door. So that's basically how it happened. So it's just like a combination of so many things in my life that just sort of converged at the same moment. So like when I do go back to work, hopefully, I don't know, maybe after the holidays, I don't know. You know, we have this thing in the books. We have it settled. You know, we know the venue. We know what we can do. Hopefully tomorrow's a huge success. And we have a lot of really important eyeballs on this show.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of important eyeballs looking at us with envious eyes or curious eyes. I just shouldn't say envious, more of curiosity. And, you know, if we plant our flag here and make a statement, I think this show can get bigger and bigger. And I for sure envision it as a 2, possibly 3-day event with multiple screenings. And
sure.
Bringing guests from Japan, more yeah. artists. I already have artists saying I want to be involved next year. Guys that worked on the IDW, Godzilla comic.
Cool.
So that's pretty much the long-winded story.
Where did your, like, where did it start for you, I guess, as your fandom of, like, kaijus in general? Or like, you know, how did that, yeah.
I think I answered this question on, like, 10 different podcasts
yeah,
in the last 2 weeks. Yeah. Earliest memory was you guys are New Yorkers.
Sure.
Do you remember Channel 5 and 11 and 9 would always play
sure.
kaiju movies?
Channel 9 I always Channel remember Channel as the 9, Godzilla
yeah.
movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, Channel 11 do the Godzilla-thon. So I was a latchkey kid, I guess. My parents were like, you know, what's
sitting... He's fine, he's 7. He'll be great.
Sit in front of the TV.
Yeah, so just watching these Godzilla movies, and then they would do a double feature with a kung fu movie. So I was the kid always into Asian cinema. All my friends were into, like... there's no Marvel stuff back then.
Yeah,
but
not really.
Star Wars, yeah. Voltron, He-Man, and they were cool. G.I. Joe, Transformers.
Losers.
Yeah, big, fat losers. No. And I was always the weirdo that was into anime and Godzilla, and now this stuff, like, there's a giant anime show with the Japs. Yeah. Anime is taking over. Kaiju is like part of our dictionary now.
Really? I mean, just even that we're saying... kaiju, right? Yeah. I mean, that's like we just would say monsters, right? For everything,
Japanese monsters.
Yeah, you know, regular people out there.
Yeah,
they would say that. Now it's like you say it, people understand.
No, people are like King Kong's a kaiju, and they get in fist fights. You know, like it's like it's just like
it's like sports fans now. Yeah, yeah, it's like Yankees and Red Sox.
I definitely think like Pacific Rim.
Yes.
Well, they like branded it. Like it was
that was
like
the movie that I think where they finally put it like a stamp on it.
Yeah.
And that movie coincides with my wedding.
That's right.
And so we got married on the day after that movie came out.
Yeah.
So we went to a midnight screening. All my groomsmen, like friends, people went to that movie. And I remember like leaving that movie and be like, I haven't heard the word kaiju used so much in a movie. And I was like, I see what they're doing. They're trying to like,
that was
like really kind of cement this into pop culture.
I was going to say that's the movie that sort of changed it, because if you notice, the legendary films use Titans.
Yeah.
Because Del Toro is a huge Ultraman fan.
Yeah.
Huge
like he knew because he was a big nerd. Like America didn't know, but he knew. So they were called like the kaiju, right? Like in that movie, they were like, that was almost the name of them, right? They weren't like all, but I did, right after that was when I started seeing like in message boards, people start, and that's when people get mad at each other. They're like, what are you talking about? You sound like a snob, you know, like trying to say kaiju, but it's over now. Like everybody, it's kaiju.
I knew that word. I had never heard it used before
as
regularly. And all of a sudden it became vernacular. Like all of a sudden it was
like we would like Godzilla, like, or King Kong's a monster. We would never call him a kaiju, but now I think probably, you know, but now it's everything. Like, Jaws is a kaiju, or is the Thing a kaiju?
Right.
Like everything.
Big Loch Ness monster. Yeah.
You know, it's like, there's gotta be some, you know, you know, got to draw a line somewhere.
Or does there?
No, I don't know. I don't think so. It's a cool name.
I'm with you. I think we could just say, hey, man, call whatever
call
you want.
Call it a kaiju.
Yeah.
And, you know, combining the word Brooklyn, it's perfect.
Yeah.
So what are, tell us a little bit about what to expect tomorrow. If folks are coming out.
Well, you know, kaiju fans are all about the collectibles. When they do the kaiju show out in Chicago, or the one I did in Japan, called Japan World Heroes in Burbank over the summer, it's all about collectible toys, sofubi, which are Japanese vinyl toys. They're very stylized, which I love. There's like statues, there's fully posable toys. That's like a kaiju, like, it's all about the toys, really. And so we're not only have great toy vendors, but we're gonna have a lot of artists, a lot of great kaiju artists. Guys like Jeff Zorno, who worked on the IDW book, Dope Pulp, Bill Couture, Steve Chanks, just to name a few. And I'm going to have t-shirts, like my officially licensed Ultimate t-shirts. So I'll be rolling in with that. So it's going to be a good mix of artists selling their kaiju art prints, good mix of toy vendors. And then we're going to do a screening of Shin Ultraman.
Right.
And we're going to have the Ultraman connection guy, EJ, do a cool, like, quick, you know, half-hour Ultraman panel on Ultraman and the state of the character in the United States, which has been growing. And Kevin Derendorf is going to do a nice intro for Shin Ultraman. He did the commentary on the Canadian version of the film.
And before we started, we talked about like our personal introduction to it.
Right.
I think we grew up the same way, watching Godzilla movies and stuff like that on WWR, WPIX, but Super Nintendo Ultraman was one of the first games that came out here.
Towards and, the future, I think. Yeah.
And I just remember, like, F-Zero, Mario,
yeah,
Mario Land, or whatever it was. Yeah. And then that was a game. And it was like, there wasn't many options that, right, that year. And we're like, all right, great. And then it was like Street Fighter. Wait a second. I've seen this guy before. I've seen that guy before.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, it was like this connected universe, which I didn't realize all these years had been a connected universe.
Right.
And then I was obsessed from that game in just learning about it. And I always knew about Ultraman. And I always kind of joked about like Jet Jaguar and whatever it is.
Oh, yeah.
And I was always like, yeah, but Ultraman is like so badass. And that game to this day holds up so great. Like I have,
I just remember him running. I remember I could like make him run away and just,
yeah, it's like, an, like for eternity. It's an emulator or whatever. Yeah. And there's, you know, you could play it on an emulator. There's like 8-10 characters,
right,
and you could use the different monsters.
It just seems like a, such a deep cut for there to even be like a Super NES game of at the time. It was like,
for
whoa,
that to be like a third or fourth title,
yeah,
of the whole launch was wild, right, to me. And again, like at that time I was like, all right, I just gobbled up whatever was there. And I remember like putting it in and being like, the fuck is this? Like, you know, like I was playing Street Fighter in the arcade. It was before that had been ported to that system.
Right.
And I was like, this is essentially just Street Fighter, but with Godzilla monsters. Like, right, this is fucking great. Like,
yeah,
who wouldn't like
this? It's a great game. Yeah. It was one of the first things I think I said to you. I was like, oh, the Super Nintendo game. I think another big part of the, well, Japanese culture in general sort of getting more and more prolific here in the States, right, and like seeping into pop culture and the influence of that. I think a big part of the kaiju fandom, obviously Ultraman and Godzilla, is the Power Rangers, right?
Right.
Is also a huge, I mean, so they are, good. That's exactly, I mean, they were little Godzilla movies, you know, is what they were. And with that, like we were talking about the millennial nostalgia coming around, like it's been 30 years since that show premiered in the States. Huge now, you know, and they've got disposable income,
right,
and they want to buy their childhood, right, back. And I think we're going to see some representation probably of some Power Ranger stuff here. Maybe even a couple Rangers themselves rolling through.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. We have one for sure coming through.
Exactly. Yeah. Exciting.
I remember being in high school and coming home.
Yeah.
And it was on in the afternoon.
Yeah.
Be like, this sucks. I'm gonna leave it on for a half hour. You know, like,
just to see the pink.
It's record. Almost yeah. over. I'm saying it's almost over. Yeah, you know, it's 3:15.
I watched
over
that.
3:30.
Yeah,
and then I'd be like, Rita, come on. You know, yeah. Like,
oh no, the Green Ranger.
Yeah,
yeah.
That flute song is so incredible. But no, I remember watching it every day.
Yeah, I watched the same thing. I come
and
home,
being like, yeah, hate watching it. But
a little bit older.
I kind of
yeah.
liked it.
Oh, it was so cheesy.
And then like
so
years later, I'd be like, it's pretty fucked.
No, cool, years later, I remember, yeah, like, I like, wish I had bought those toys because they were amazing toys. Like, they were like, you know, Voltron, but like so many different
and
kinds.
Yeah. Those fucking, they did some crazy rubber monsters on there.
So great. Oh, yeah.
That are so fucking goofball nuts. And you're like, wait a second. Why didn't I appreciate this more? Because if it was a thing from the 60s or if it was a nostalgia thing to me, I'd be like, oh, man. It holds a place for me, because it was every day, like it was clockwork. They were just pumping these fucking things out. And then like a series would end and another series would start.
Cause you were looking at it, you're in high school. And again, you're like a little bit cynical and like, this is new, this is for kids. And then once I was a little older, I'm like, this is amazing. It's pure camp. Like it's a mini guy. They're so funny and you can watch them one after the other.
My brother is 10 years younger than me.
Right.
So he's a full demographic younger than me.
Right.
And he was a fucking huge Power Rangers kid.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's kind of shitty. And then I was like, sitting there like, fucking monster's great. Like the fucking, you know,
the
pig, like
the
everything
pig,
about it is awesome. And, you know, Zoran and all this shit. And I'm like, I shouldn't know anything about this. Like I've never literally sat down and seeked out watching an episode.
Right.
But yet I know so much about Power Rangers.
Yeah. It's part of our pop culture.
Yeah. And as I got older, I appreciated it so much more.
Like it's a big one up there. Like the nostalgia for it is huge. And you know, we'll get a gritty, serious reboot probably at some point.
We got that one from,
well, they did like a movie a couple of years ago, and then they did like the kind of the reunion movie like last year or whatever.
The one from a couple of years ago, they tried to do that like hard reunion.
Yeah, a little more serious. Yeah.
That was Elizabeth Banks.
Didn't quite land. Repulsor, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah, she was great. But it did what it did. But I remember watching that being like, I want to see this. Why do I want to see this? I shouldn't be the target.
Did you see the one on Netflix like last one was great, because that was like a real love letter to that first season of it, and really, you know, rest in peace Green Ranger, you know, but
Tommy,
yeah, that was a bummer.
My son Logan is 7. He fucking loves that shit.
Yeah,
because it's just so action orientated. Yeah. And my oldest son never got into the Power Rangers, but like it's got a new life for a younger audience, so that's great.
Well, you want to hear the interesting thing is when I started doing shows back in 15, I was sort of afraid that everyone that would buy from me or any other artist would look like me and older, like, you know, like a gray, you know, and I was
gray,
like,
beard,
a lot of gray beards.
Right,
and
right,
I noticed early on that it wasn't the case, and I noticed every time I do the show, like a show since 2015, it gets younger and younger, to the point where my friends are like, oh, my kids love this, we're gonna come stop by your booth. And I'm like, this is great, because I think the legendary movies, which I'm not a fan of, they're not my Godzilla, but there's someone else's Godzilla, and it's reigniting, it's starting a new fire in these kids to like seek out the Godzilla movies and start that all over again.
Absolutely.
Which is great for me.
Absolutely.
The King Kong Godzilla movie was one of HBO Max's release.
That's right.
For COVID.
During COVID, yeah.
Right. You know, and it was like Disney Plus was like, we're going to do this for COVID. Hamilton for COVID. And they were like, we're going to do King Kong versus fucking Godzilla. And I was like, we don't have to go to the theater to see this. Yeah. And I remember Logan being like, who the fuck is King Kong? Like, he's 7. Yeah. Like, he has no clue.
Right.
And then all of a sudden he's like, can we watch this again? Like 4 days later, he's watching it for the 5th time.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden he's like the biggest Godzilla fan ever. And you're like, how did this fucking happen?
What's
like,
gateway content that you're talking about? Anything that brings you in. So, I mean, it's easy to sometimes be cynical and be like, this is terrible. But everything leads. Everything that's raising.
It all goes back to Godzilla.
If it's raising up and it's bringing. Because, I mean, anything that I ever got into growing up, you always, if you get into it, then you go find the other thing. You know, if it was some shitty Dracula version, then, you know, it would kind of find
the
original thing.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, and lead you back. So the legendary movies, they have their place. And
they have their place.
They have their fandom. I mean, we even, he's not here tonight, but there's this one of our tech guys was 8 years old when the 98 Godzilla came out. And just, I mean, if you were a child, you loved it, you know?
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
Like, it
and
just
it
was
sucked.
What it was. And you had, because you had no,
it did suck. No, it totally sucked.
You had no expectations. You had nothing else to compare it to. Totally, yeah, no, it's
Taco Bell commercials, dope. Yeah.
But we all remember the hype and the merch and like everything. I always say, I'm like, they should have just called that movie like they did Independence Day. They should have just called it Memorial Day. And it should have just been about a big monster and we would have all liked it way much better.
Yeah,
I think.
Taco Bell.
That was their big one.
Like, that was that fucking little dog getting fucking swept up by Godzilla. Absolutely.
But it's got its own cult following. That's 25 years old. It has its own little cult following now. And like, it's a
Matthew Broderick.
It's a notorious failure, right? Like, you know, and there's midnight screenings of it now, you know.
P. Diddy and fucking
Led Zeppelin. Like Showgirls as like a cult film.
Yeah, exactly.
Without the insane sex scene under the fountain, which everybody tunes in.
And just the hubris and just like.
I would watch Godzilla in the sex scene under the fountain. I would watch that, but it doesn't exist.
Central Park.
Yeah, it doesn't exist.
In the Great Fountain.
But we should make that happen for Godzilla 2024.
We'll see. And so the Shin Ultraman will be our big screening tomorrow, which is sort of the let's say serious, the newest serious line of a lot of these kaiju things.
From Japan,
Shin Godzilla,
Shin Kamen Rider.
And that was the most recent one.
Yeah, Shin Ultraman.
And Shin Ultraman, which I'm really looking forward to seeing with the crowd. And I mean, your work is so cool.
Oh, thank you.
With the Ultraman thing, and it's always a great brand. I always thought he was so cool. Again, it was pre Power Rangers. Again, I always liked, like, I thought him and Jet Jaguar were the same person, but as a child, you know, because you didn't know what it was.
It's all about like the positioning of the hands and the styling of the pose.
It's very Aikido. It's all very defensive moves, tossing kaiju.
It's really great. And then I remember like having some friends who had older brothers.
Yeah.
And we were like getting into like things like D&D or, you know, comics or whatever it was.
Right.
And they were like hand-me-downs from these guys.
Right.
And then like they would be watching this shit. Yeah. And like I was like, what the fuck is that? Like, is that a Godzilla movie? And they're like, no. You know, like it's obviously not. This is way. And it was very inaccessible for me because I was like, oh, I remember seeing it. But I don't remember it. And then all of a sudden that game dropped into my lap and I was like,
yeah,
I fucking know this. And now I feel like that guy. Like, I'm like, oh man, I've been on Ultraman for a long time.
Good.
So when the Shin Ultraman was announced, I was like, yes. Yeah. And like, I fucking saw it and I was like, man, this is like beautiful. Like, that's this is exactly what I like to
that's
see.
That's so cool.
That's awesome.
Well, thanks again, John. We're going to be working all day tomorrow. We're going to be here. We'll probably pull you on for the stream tomorrow.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, you know, again, thank you for, you know, bringing this to us. And we're so happy to be collaborating with you and looking forward for an insane day.
Yeah, thank you again for inviting me in.
Try to get a little bit of sleep tonight. I'm going to do my best.
Yeah. I got to be up early tomorrow, but I'm going to do my best.
Somebody's got to wreck this whole town, you know? Yeah. So.
But really, I mean, that's, again, we were talking about our brand was always about kind of like pop culture with a little bit of a New York slant to it. And, you know, another New Yorker we're happy to have in our ranks, you know, like fighting the good fight.
Local, too. 5 minutes
totally
away.
Local. Super easy. I mean, what a
neighbors. Commute. We're neighbors.
That's what I'm saying. Like, you're like going back to work. I'm like, this is going to be our work, John. This is it. We're going to do this. This is what we're going
to do. I want this to be my day job. Can you guys please all show up and make this my day job?
We're working on it. Well, you've got the rights, you know, so you're keeping us legit. So
doing my best.
That helps. Well, thanks again, John, and good luck with the event tomorrow. We'll be here and awesome. Talk to you then.
Yeah, I'll be here.
John Robo 7, follow John. I think it's up on the screens. He's awesome, and buy his stuff and come tomorrow and see him and see us. Guys, going to bed.
What do you think? I got to ask a question.
Okay.
Favorite side character of these kind of kaiju movies?
I am a big fan of Jet Jaguar, but I have from that same movie, I'm a big fan of Gigan from, and he does a little, the clingy clingy, has the two hooks. He goes, clang, 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 which is one of my favorites, guys. I think I have a Gigan t-shirt I think I want to wear tomorrow.
I have always been so impartial to Ghidorah.
Sure.
He's fucking so...
Monster Zero.
But like so monstrous, like looking. Like at the time, I remember being like, what the fuck could be better than that? Like
it's crazy.
Crazy three-headed, you know, like whatever. And now I've been exploring more of the origin movies of him. And I'm like, man, like from the minute he comes on the screen.
So
impressive.
Almost every one I think that he's been in is, even the legendary one, it's the reverence for him. He's the ultimate, right? The guy, like he's the big guy. Like Godzilla's obviously the big, but Godzilla they've made goofy at times, they've made whatever. King Ghidorah's always been played straight, you know,
and I
as
think
a threat.
In Marvel Comics recently, like we had the whole King in Black storyline.
Uh-huh.
And I feel like that's the same thing. It's like this kind of, you know, when they did like Gore the God Butcher and they did all this stuff, they played it straight. Like they were like, yeah, we're introducing a new character, but this new character is going to like really be able to influence all these older characters. And you're like, yeah, that's not going to happen. Like eventually you're going to be like, it's fucking Thor. Your Thor's going to crack him with the hammer and it's going to be over. And then all of a sudden, a year in, you're like, this fucking, they're playing this guy straight. And I think they did that with Ghidorah, and I think they kept it going for a long time. And I think that's kind of one of the cool things. Like, they had the throwaway monsters.
Right.
So they didn't need the throwaway monster. And so, you know, I watched a few with him that I had never seen before, and it really fucking blew me away. Just such amazing design.
That's great. I think I remember us doing the legendary, which is, I think, maybe 2014. As well. It's been a long time since that one came out. We did a whole review of one of the first CCD podcasts, I think, was us with our good friend Jeff Bond. And he was like, he shot down that guy's neck. I mean, it was one of the best quotes when he kills the thing at the end, the Motu.
And then I think he...
Muto.
He also gave us the... What was it? The Brian...
a transition to Cox? Yeah about Brian. Cox. Yeah, that was unrelated to the... Yeah.
That was it was like a similar... Jeff gave us lots of great material.
Well, Mike, I mean, I'm just so happy to be sitting here with you doing this. I mean, remembering when you... I remember one of the first times we were meeting and hanging out, and it was, I think it was at Kate's wedding, your sister-in-law. And I remember we were talking about the Wolverine Origins movie had just come out, and you were talking about that, and you were talking about how he was naked and how great it was, and like I was like we started talking a little bit about pop culture stuff, and I was like, this guy's cool. And then you had the site, the blog, and I was like, I was trying to figure out how to get my way, and I was trying to create, and I knew I wanted to put something else. But I remember my perception, like, this guy's got it all together. I'm like, this guy's got what I
know shit about shit.
This guy's got it all worked out. All I need is someone like with a website and just to kind of help. So, but I do appreciate you, you know, taking me on and letting me work with you and trusting me with the brand and everything like that.
Well, and I always say, like, I had this like germ of idea. And like most of the germs of ideas that I have, it's like, it sounds good on paper, but putting it into execution was like, all right, great. Now I'm going to do this. And then once it started kind of germinating, so to speak, and people started kind of reacting to it, I was like, great. Now, so let's get everybody involved. And meeting you very early on, and then you being like, so this is what I want to do. I want to do this, this, and this. And I was like, yeah, I want to do that too. We should do that. And it was never about like, okay, what this is my thing. What are you going to do? How are you going to bring your thing? And then once it became your thing, so to speak, it was never like, oh, well, that's not my thing anymore. I always felt like it's ours and it's always been ours. And, you know, all the different people that we've collaborated with through the years, whether it's once or numerous times,
yeah,
it just makes this like amazing network of people. And, I think a long time ago, I came to grips with the fact that it's like, all right, maybe we're never going to be the most well-known people. But if you talk to anybody who knows us, who worked with us, who did anything with us, they're going to be like, those fucking guys are cool.
Yeah, well, I think we've always...
That's it. Like, they're cool dudes that you're never going to fucking have to deal with in a negative way. And that was always my approach.
I think that was always what we tried to do, was to be low... you know, stress, and like we were never really chasing anything. And this is why, you know, Anthony and I have always gotten along really well, and we haven't been over pitching. We haven't been trying to compare ourselves. Like, we were never like trying to be Nerdist. Like, we were never
thank goodness
emulating ourselves after something else. We were always just trying to be authentic and like you said, create this kind of stuff that we want to see and just do it for fun. And then working under the assumption that if we kind of do that and be authentic and consistent, that good things will come.
Conversations though, like, you know, and it's like, everybody always says like, you know, what is said now 30 years from now will be looked upon as history. Right. And so like, I collect a lot of like 80s and 90s nostalgia, and like reading the blurbs and things that are written about movies from that time, and then knowing how it's played out over the last 20 years, I'm like, this is bullshit. Like, half shit is bullshit. Like, everybody was just doing a gig back then. And like, our thing was always like, we're not going to do a gig. Like, we're just going to be honest.
Right.
And like, if I loved Hudson Hawk 20 years ago, right, why would I not love Hudson Hawk right now? In just because we're in Industry City and we have a better space, like, what the fuck? Like, I'm gonna still be the same guy. You're gonna still be the same guy. Everybody that we've been a part of, and now that we've branched out a little bit and gotten all these different people, way more successful than we'll ever be.
Yeah.
They're fucking awesome, and they treat us like great.
Yeah, it's great.
Wonderful people, and like I said, Tommy's terrible person. So for people to treat Tommy nice is amazing. And they love Tommy. I don't understand it personally. But it's just such an outpouring. Every time we get somebody on the show, they're like, so when can I do it again? And I'm like, do it again? I didn't even think you'd do it the first time. Like, this is amazing. So all jokes aside, it's really amazing to be a part of this tonight and a part of this at this point in 2023. Can't believe we've come this far, but there's so much further to go. So
that's great. Well, I'll plug my stuff, and then you can send us home with Jack Kirby and talk about it. But like, Kaiju Brooklyn, you know, come down and check us out in Industry City if you're around tomorrow, or at least watch this live stream on this exact place. And keep watching Brooklyn One Productions. That's where anything really CCD and our efforts will be flowing through that brand and that channel. We have a lot of things that we're hoping to do, more podcasts and more screenings, and a lot of stuff that I'm hoping to accomplish, and of course continuing yours.
Yeah, and again, thank you to Anthony for always kind of being the binding force between everything that we've been doing over the last couple of years. BK1, so happy for them, so happy for us. Shout out to Tommy Lumberdozy, my co-creator of Jack Kirby. I love him so much, and he couldn't be here tonight. Usually I'm the one who's not around when you guys do these Brooklyn things, but he couldn't make it, but he makes the show go, and as miserable as he is, we love him so much. And then finally, just looking forward to what we have coming up. Jacktoberfest, you know, Jacktober, we're continuing. We have some great guests coming up, and some fun material for you guys in October. And then, you know, as always, we post every day, trying to familiarize people with Jack Kirby's work. Things that you think you know about Jack Kirby, you find something new every day. And we have some events coming up that are just huge events, with Roy Schwartz and Jack Kirby Museum, so many other things that we have coming up. So stay tuned to our space at @Jacked_Kirby on Instagram. We post every day, podcast once a week. Do the best we can for what we got. That's all I could say.
End it the way, you know, you guys usually.
Peace.